You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. I'm Professor Gus Martin, and today we're going to discuss the typology of international terrorism. International terrorism is conceptually not difficult to understand, but we have to understand why it happens and the perceptions of international terrorism. That's what's important about this, because we sit using a certain perspective about what it is. Well, other people have very different interpretations of why it occurs and whether it is indeed terrorism. So we will explore this. If you have any questions, please feel free to call and we'll answer your questions. We'll discuss whatever you would like to discuss. The number is 310-928-7330, or please just send an email and we will discuss whatever it is that you want to have discussed. During this particular lecture, you can do this live, or if you want to look at one of the recorded versions of this lecture, please send me an email or call me at my office, and I will answer any of your questions in the next broadcast. So, let us begin by discussing terrorist spillovers, international terrorism. And the photograph that you see on the screen is an example of perhaps the most successful example or case of international terrorism. Of course, that's Manhattan, and that is when the second plane hit the buildings of the World Trade Center on September 11th, 2001. Now, in order to understand international terrorism, we are going to have a particular conceptual approach to this. We're going to begin our discussion by defining what international terrorism actually is. It's important to define this because many people just assume that all terrorism is international, but it's not. As we know, we've discussed domestic terrorism. Second, we're going to look for the reasons for international terrorism. Remember that the people who engage in what we refer to as international terrorism believe that it is a legitimate, logical, strategic choice. And then we're going to enter into the debate about whether there is any such thing as an international terrorist conspiracy. And the reason we're going to mention this is because many people do believe that there are many terrorist conspiracies, but many people kind of have come to the conclusion that there is an international terrorist conspiracy. So we're going to just address this theory just so that it is summarized for your understanding. Now, let us define international terrorism. Understand this concept of spilling over, the so-called spillover effect. What this means is, it's an important concept, and what this means is that the struggle, the revolution, if you will, spills over into the international domain. This involves either domestic attacks against victims with an international profile or actual operations in a foreign country. The image that you see on your screen are the remains of a Pan Am flight that was blown up over Lockerbie, Scotland. And it is a good example of international terrorism. We'll come back to this case study. But in order to discuss this, understand this. When we talk about domestic attacks against victims with an international profile, it means that domestic violence spills over into the international domain. So the attack occurs domestically, but the target has an international symbolism attached to it. For example, an attack against any diplomat that's in another country is an example of international terrorism because the diplomat represents the country that has the embassy within that host country. Or members of certain businesses, perhaps CEOs of a business. They symbolize the actual multinational corporation. So this could be an example of international terrorism. And unfortunately, attacks do occur against tourists. Tourists are often targets of terrorists in other countries. Tourists view themselves as simply being civilians on holiday. But from an extremist point of view, a tourist can actually represent an enemy people or an enemy country. So for example, in January of 1997, in Rwanda, Hutu militants shot and killed three Spanish workers from an organization known as Doctors of the World. They wounded one citizen of the United States, who unfortunately had to have his leg amputated later. And this is a good example of a domestic insurgent group engaging in international terrorism by attacking a symbolic target that is located in their particular country. Another scenario is when there are operations that are carried out in a foreign country. In other words, an extremist or terrorist actually travels to the foreign country and engages in the terrorist violence. So there are the terrorist operative is actually traveling to engage in this activity. Now, an example of this is in February of 1997 in the United States, when a Palestinian gunman opened fire on tourists atop the Empire State Building. A Danish national was killed, and tourists were wounded who came from the United States, Argentina, Switzerland, and France. The Palestinian gunman committed suicide, but a note was found, a handwritten note was found, which said that it claimed that the attack was punishment against the enemies of Palestine. And then, 1994, in Buenos Aires, Argentina, a very important case study that we will reference later, there was a bombing at the Argentine-Israelite Mutual Association, the equivalent of perhaps a Jewish community center in the United States. The bombing killed 85 people and wounded 200. A group calling itself Ansar Allah claimed credit, but it was probably actually Lebanon's Hezbollah that engaged in this attack against a Jewish center in Buenos Aires, Argentina. So what you can see here is that simply because the target was a Jewish target, or largely Jewish target, they viewed it as being an attack against Zionism, attack against Israeli interests, even though this was in Buenos Aires, Argentina. Now, another concept to keep in mind is that there must be unambiguous international implications. The international consequences must be clear, and there are many cases of international consequences being clear. In a moment, we're going to see a video about the Black September assault that we have discussed before involving Leila Khaled. And in this video, you'll actually hear Leila Khaled being interviewed about this attack on Black September. So the cases in point that we look at are things like attacks on Black September, attacks against ships, airline hijackings, etc. So let us look at this video just so that we understand this idea, this concept of there being unambiguous international implications.
6th of September, 1970. A Palestinian guerrilla group carries out simultaneous hijackings on four planes bound for New York City.
This has probably been the most hazardous day ever plotted in the history of air travel.
I was threatening, telling them, if you don't open the door, I will explode the plane.
I turned around and this passenger was pointing a gun at me.
The last thing I heard from her was the calm, steady and very British voice of her captain, saying he was going to take her up to 6,000 feet.
The hostages became caught up in a media spectacular played out in front of the world's press.
The aim was to reach to the minds of people in the West.
Raising the question, should governments negotiate with hijackers?
The hijackers said that they'd blow the plane and passengers up if anyone tried to approach.
They're desperate men, they feel they've been done a wrong, and to get their ends, they will do what they say.
Sometimes I think, oh, it may be home tomorrow, but other times I think, He won't get out of it.
With interviews from hijackers, hostages, and their families at home, tonight, Time Watch takes you back to the day that air travel changed forever. El Al, Flight 219, en route from Amsterdam to New York. This woman is traveling on a fake passport. Her real name is Leila Khaled, and she is a highly trained member of the guerrilla group, the PFLP, the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine. This man, whose real name is Patrick Arguello, is an American-born sympathizer of the Palestinian cause. In a few moments, they are going to attempt to hijack this plane in the name of the PFLP. The PFLP's primary goal was to recapture territory it considered stolen by Israel and to return it to the Palestinian people. It was one of the largest groups in the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization, second only to Yasser Arafat's Fatah Party. Palestinians living in refugee camps in Lebanon, Syria, and Jordan swelled the party's membership. Many of these refugees had fled from their homes in 1948, following the creation of the State of Israel. One of those to have left her hometown of Haifa was Leila Khaled. She had grown up in exile in Lebanon.
All the time, I was asking, and my sisters and brothers were asking, why are we living like that? Why did we leave Haifa? Because we had a house, we were well off, while here we have nothing. And all the time my mother was answering that we are going back and we have to go back.
Initially, PFLP Fedayeen trained in regular guerrilla fighting techniques to achieve their goal.
We had to be trained to use pistols and machine guns, and also how to use explosives.
But it was soon apparent that a ground war was not winnable. Instead, the PFLP launched a campaign against the civilian air fleets of Israel and her Western allies.
The weak will choose his own way in hitting the weak points of the strong. Shocking the world would come with something shocking.
The starboard side caught the worst of the attack and was sprayed with bullets from submachine guns in five bursts of fire.
His cabin was filled with smoke after the explosion, and his last words are reported here in Switzerland today as, "I can't see anything. Goodbye, everyone."
These violent acts cost many innocent lives and received worldwide condemnation, especially in Israel. El Al responded by tightening its security. Hiding among the passengers were armed sky marshals.
We had to scream, "Stay in your places, nobody moves." We ran directly to the front, heading to the cockpit.
I picked up the galley phone. And as a security measure, there was a specific button that I was supposed to press.
When the door wouldn't open, they took the stewardess and told her, "Come with us to the door. Yell to them to open it up. If they don't open it, we'll kill you. We'll shoot you."
Ayali, flight engineer.
I had a flight engineer who was looking out of a peephole in the cockpit door and could see what was happening.
He was just screaming, telling him, if you don't open the door, I will explode the plane.
The hijacker saw me moving, and he came over to me and shot me in the leg. He said, if you move again, I'll shoot you. I took another step forward and I jumped on the hijacker. He shot me in the shoulder, but I caught hold of his gun the way I had been trained to do. I hit him hard against the door with my right hand, and we both fell on the floor.
Because I had come from the Air Force and I was a combat pilot, I had the idea of negative G, whereby you throw the plane into a steep dive.
It was going vertically, very rapidly.
When we were lying on the ground, he and I were struggling. The security guard came running up from behind, and he stood over us and shot his whole magazine. I got two bullets. We were lying on each other, and he got three bullets.
And we started to wrestle, and she was strong. The first thing I did was I grabbed her hair. Suddenly, I had her wig in my hand. In the end, she surrendered. I took my tie off, which was the only thing I could tie her with. I took my tie off, and then we bound her hands.
And I realized that we couldn't do it. At that moment, I realized that.
20 minutes after takeoff from Amsterdam, Captain Yuri Barlev diverted LL Flight 219 to London Heathrow. On its arrival, Leila Khaled was arrested by the British authorities. But the LL hijack was just one part of the PFLP's bigger plan.
So understand, please, the significance of that particular case. That was the dawn of modern airline hijacking, which has been replicated dozens of times since then. And there's a reason for that. The world ignored the plight of the Palestinian people when they were engaging in classical guerrilla warfare, the idea of hit, run, fight forever. And they were literally going across the border, striking inside of Israel, and then going back. And they were losing. They were not winning. So then these hijackings occurred with airliners that represent different nations, and the world began to pay attention to them. So airlines became symbolic of nations, and when an airliner is hijacked, if they have individuals on board from 10 different countries, then those 10 different countries will pay attention to the cause of the terrorists who have hijacked the plane. So keep this in mind. Now, just to understand this idea of dissident terrorism on the world stage, once again, there have been any number of groups that have engaged in international terrorism. Their home countries, of course, pay attention to them to some extent, but the world did not. So what we see are a series of incidents that occurred on the world stage, and that the targets were symbolic of international interests or their enemy interests, but the incident occurred, of course, on the world stage. And there was always, or usually anyway, an international effect, with meaning things like an increased profile in the international media and among international policy makers. Now, keeping all of that in mind, I just want to mention this idea that there are any number of terrorist typologies that we have discussed and we're about to discuss soon, criminal terrorism, but just understand that within these environments, international terrorism can occur in all of them. Governments, dissidents, religious motivations, left-wing and right-wing terrorists, all have used the international stage, if you will, as a platform to air their grievances. So all of these typologies have used terrorism internationally in order to garner attention from the world and to affect international behavior, global behavior. And here we have a summary of all of them. We see that all of these environments, all of these typologies have engaged in different kinds of attacks, including one that we mentioned, Lockerbie, Scotland in 1988. Libyan intelligence officers did this. Dissidents, you see that Hezbollah in the Buenos Aires attack against a Jewish community center. And it goes on with every single typology that we have discussed. Which brings us to a subject that I just want to everyone to understand, this idea of modern isms and international revolutionary solidarity. During the Cold War rivalry between the capitalist West and the communist East, there were motivations for international resistance. In other words, excuses were given, in a sense, reasons were given, that included terms such as imperialism, neocolonialism, and Zionism. So these were the ideologies of national liberation. Remember national liberation, this concept that certain indigenous peoples had to rise up against colonial powers or against governments that were actually in league with the colonial powers. So the so-called wars of national liberation used these ideas, imperialism, neocolonialism, and Zionism, to engage in their resistance. Marxist rebels used all of these at some period. Not always, but they used them in some period, some environments, as reasons for their resistance. Now, this concept of imperialism. The image that you see on your screen is a representation of 19th century British or German or French imperialism. During that period and even before, this concept of imperialism was not always a bad word. It referred to empire building. And all you have to do is just look at a map of the Middle East or a map of the continent of Africa and observe the borders. Largely very neatly drawn or following a river or a mountain a range or something like that, understand that those borders are largely colonial borders that were drawn up by European colonial powers. So that if you look at Africa, they have nothing to do with the ethnicity or the nationality necessarily of the people who are within the border of the country. They simply represent what in England or France, or Germany, or Spain, Portugal, etc. It goes on and on. It represents where their colonial borders were. So this was a good thing from their point of view. Well, the anti-imperialist resistance within these countries often became internationalized. Many of the Cold War proxy wars, these wars of national liberation, used the term of imperialism regularly to justify their resistance against the capitalist West, saying that the capitalist West was still engaging in forms of imperialism and that these Marxist rebels were simply liberating themselves. And this was frequently done internationally. Another concept to keep in mind is this concept of neo-colonialism, which most of us probably have never heard of, or if we have, we've never used it. In other countries, the term neocolonialism is known. It refers to the new colonialism. Remember traditional standard colonialism. It simply involved moving certain segments of the population of an imperial country to new land. Well, there were people on that new land, and they were displaced. And just think about the Western Hemisphere, North America, Central America, and South America. Most people do not speak indigenous languages. Most people speak Spanish, English, French, Portuguese, Dutch. These are clearly European languages that were imposed by colonial populations. So that is classical colonialism, Remember that there were the 13 colonies of the United States rose up against its imperial center, but they're still colonies. Now, neocolonialism refers to economic exploitation. So, multinational corporations or simply ruling elites in other countries are viewed as being used by an outside capitalist power such as the United States or a country in Western Europe in order to exploit the economic reserves of the host country. So, in other words, neocolonialist resistance or resistance against neocolonialism may very well involve attacking those economic interests or those who favor those economic interests. So there could be attacks against oil facilities, representatives of oil companies, or perhaps members of a government that is viewed as being in the economic pocket of the West. So neocolonialism is another justification for international resistance against that kind of perceived exploitation. And then we have the term Zionism. Zionism is different. It's used as a justification, but it is a different kind of concept. So Zionism is often a target of anti-imperialists. But remember, we've mentioned this concept before. Zionism refers to an ideology or an intellectual movement that posited the return of the scattered Jewish people, scattered throughout the world, to the homeland, to Israel or Palestine. In other words, the return to Zion referred to the return of the many scattered groups of Jewish populations throughout the world after 2,000 years of being in a diaspora, returning to their ancestral homeland. In a nutshell, that is what Zionism refers to. Zionism is a basis for the existence of the State of Israel. Many Israelis, in fact, the Israeli government, perceives itself as being a Zionist state. So that ideology is attacked, resistance to that ideology is used as a reason for attacks against Jewish interests throughout the world. And you can see the danger here. Here, this can often become anti-Semitic violence. As we mentioned with the attack in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, it was perceived as being an anti-Zionist attack, even though this was far away from the Middle East, far away from Israel. So it was an anti-Semitic attack. And we see that Zionism is used by Arab nationalists or Islamists or white supremacists, white nationalists in the United States, neo-Nazis internationally, as a reason for attacks against Jewish interests. So unlike imperialism and neocolonialism, Zionism crosses that line, that barrier, into attacks against an ethnic group, attacks against a national group, attacks against a religious group. And these justifications occur very frequently when you see these attacks by Islamists or Arab nationalists or by white nationalists and other people, other groups. If you have any questions, please do feel free to phone in or send an email to me. We can do this during the live presentation, or as many people have done, you can send it to me when you have viewed the recorded version. So feel free to do that, phone in or send an email. Now, let us explore this further by looking at the practical reasons for international terrorism. There's a simple practicality to using international terrorism or engaging in it. There's a potential for maximum publicity, a potential for inflicting maximum psychological anxiety, and simple pragmatism. And so here is what we mean by this. Maximum publicity. Once again, think about Black September and the Palestinian cause. The world ignored the Palestinian cause until Black September. the potential for inflicting maximum psychological anxiety. Well, we can reference as a case study of that as the Zionism as being used as a rationale for attacks. We see this rationale being used for attacks in Germany, New Zealand, the United States, Israel, Argentina, and elsewhere. And then pragmatism. This refers to simply a pragmatic reason or a pragmatic method for a relatively weak cause to engage in high profile, high impact terrorism, which they normally would not receive unless they were on the international stage. And very importantly, the image you see on your screen is Mao Zedong, who is arguably the father, the founder of modern-day guerrilla warfare, and his concept has been internationalized. Remember that Mao posited the concept that a revolutionary is a fish, they represent the fish swimming in the sea of the people. They disappear among the people and appear only to attack. The idea is to hit, run, and fight forever. Now, that concept of hitting, running, and fighting forever has been taken into the international domain by modern-day revolutionaries. We refer to it as terrorism. They view it as being a classical guerrilla war in their own minds. Marighella, remember we've talked about him? He wrote the book, The Mini-Manual of the Urban Guerrilla. He believed in enraging the beast, causing the enemy to overreact, and when the people see the enemy overreacting, they will rise up. So that is being practiced internationally. I can guarantee you that many of the Islamists and others in the Middle East are attempting to enrage Israel, attempting to enrage the United States and others as a way to demonstrate how ruthless we can be, if you will. And then lastly, Frantz Fanon, the concept of liberating violence. Adapting this revolutionary theory to practice means that simply the only way that one can find oneself, the only way that one can find true liberation or become truly committed is through violence. And we see this in the modern era repeatedly. One good case study of this would be the suicide bombings, the people who engage in these attacks intending to die. Not simply having a possibility of dying, but they want to die. They intend to die. That form of liberating violence is one that is admired within the circles that these terrorists come from. So just understand this. You know, we may say this is insane. It makes no sense. But it makes perfect logical sense from their point of view, from their perspective. Now, we are going to take a break, a 5-minute break, and after we do take this break, we're going to come back and look at history, the historical reasons for engaging international terrorism, this idea that there are certain perceptions that they do not align with each other, that people in the developing world have and people in the developed world have. So let us go to the break, and then we'll come back and discuss this concept of perceptions of international terrorism from the perspective of history. We'll go to our break now.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
The feeling I had when I was here as a student was that I could do anything.
Sure, keep striving and keep reaching high, but at the same time, also lift up those around you.
I want to get up and work hard to change things for the future, to make things better. How do I make my passion come to life?
How can I share that experience?
How to shape and engage the community.
Get hands-on into making a difference.
My name is McConan.
My name is Johnny.
My name is Amarantha, and I'm a Toro.
Surround yourself with people who share the same goals as you. If you believe it, you can do it.
Watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, and welcome back to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. I'm Professor Gus Martin, and today we're discussing the concept of international terrorism. If you have any questions, please feel free to phone in your question, and we'll discuss it, or send us an email, and your email will be discussed also. Now, before the break, we mentioned that we're going to look at perceptions of international terrorism. And here we're talking about historical reasons. This is very important to understand because there are two classifications that we're going to look at. One is Western norms of conflict versus the developing world, and then Western accepted modes of warfare versus the developing world. And what we mean by this is the following. Remember that concept of one person's terrorist is another person's freedom fighter. This is what we're getting into when we look at the perceptions of international terrorism. The background is that the Cold War adversaries used different labels for the same concept. In the East, there were wars of national liberation, post-war anti-colonial wars. Some of them were wars of national liberation against colonial powers. For example, in French Indochina and French Algeria. And then the West would arm and train what they perceived to be, or what they labeled, as freedom fighters. Some of these wars were, arguably, resistance against aggression. For example, the Greek Civil War was a war against communist aggression. But all sides could certainly be extremist in how they acted out. So always remember that the truth is somewhere in between what you're being told. There's the truth that does exist, but very often the truth is spun as a form of propaganda. So, acts of terrorism have been viewed differently by the West and the developing world. There's no question about that. The first perspective is this idea of Western norms of conflict. Remember that the West does not like terrorism. It's always being denounced, or what they denounce violence as being terrorism. That is because there is a belief in the West, at least its ideology says this, that there is a belief in democratic justice as a norm. That is at least what is said. It does, clearly there are exceptions to that and many examples where that did not occur. So the norm is one in which there are certain rules of engagement. This idea that there should be no authoritarianism, no vigilantism, well, okay, those are noble goals. And so the West will perceive certain norms, certain rules of engagement as being the way wars should be fought. In the same vein, there are accepted modes of warfare. The West has certain rules about what constitutes a fair fight. The best way to think about this is to imagine the American Revolution. The British Army had rules of engagement in which they would dress in red, march in a straight line, and beat a drum to announce that they were coming. And then battles would be fought where one lined up across a battlefield and just shot at each other and then charged each other with bayonets drawn. Okay, that was warfare from the British redcoat perspective. The American Continentals shot at them from behind rocks and trees and fences and then ran away. They engaged in guerrilla warfare in the American South and elsewhere. They shot British officers intentionally. They would simply have sharpshooters sitting in trees shooting at their lieutenants, captains, and generals, whoever it might be, who were sitting on horses. From the British point of view, they didn't use the word terrorism, but they viewed these continentals, these colonial forces, as being fighting a dirty war. So in the modern era, one may be able to think about the West as being the new redcoats. They have their rules, but the other side does not use the same rules as we do. So just keep that in mind, that internationally speaking, in the modern era, the West could be perceived as being the new redcoats, and the other side are denounced as terrorists because they are breaking the rules. Now, remember this, the perceptions. There are reasons for these perceptions. The so-called Third World during the Cold War era was one in which the developing world was viewed as being the battlefield. So what we see now is that the West is often a target during the wars of national liberation because the developing world was the battlefield. And then the anti-colonial rebels became national leaders. The George Washingtons and Thomas Jeffersons of the developing world were once in the hills or the jungles or the deserts with rifles on their backs attacking colonial forces. Remember that Nelson Mandela spent a couple of decades in prison on Robben Island in South Africa. He has now gone down in history as being a great statesman, as being largely responsible through sheer force of will for bringing the South African nation together and avoiding a racial civil war. Nelson Mandela was a lawyer who belonged to an extremist group that detonated bombs. In other words, he belonged to a movement that engaged in what we would call terrorism. And so that is why he was arrested and sent to prison. And yet, he is the equivalent of a George Washington or a Thomas Jefferson for South Africa. And he's greatly respected in today's world. Another reason is that terrorism was used in the anti-colonial wars as a matter of pragmatism. It was used repeatedly. Remember that the insurgents, what the West would call terrorists, were fighting against well-armed and well-trained European armies or their hired or their allies. So what we would call terrorism was an effective method of warfare. It was useful propaganda. It demoralized the enemy, and it created disorder. They made the war, the cost of the war, unacceptable to the colonial power. We saw this repeatedly, and we saw the British leave Palestine after the bombing of the King David Hotel. The British public turned against the war. So the wars, these anti-colonial wars, became too costly for the colonial power. Simply remember Mao Zedong's admonition that one should hit, run, and fight forever. The anti-imperialist or anti-colonial forces understand that this particular occupying force will go home someday. So even if it takes a generation or two generations, if the war continues, they will eventually go home. And we see this repeatedly. The American case is very clear. It shows that we have withdrawn from different regions or different conflicts when we decided that the cost was too high. And they know that. The other side, the opponents, know that. They are very intelligent about just carrying on this concept of hit, run, and fight forever. Then there is this idea of a fusion of ideology and warfare, which we have talked about before, with this idea that Marxism is very useful, but also just the concepts of anti-imperialism, anti-colonialism, and anti-Zionism. That is a fusion of ideology and warfare, very useful. There is greater opportunity for publicity when fighting in the international arena. This idea of a poor man's warfare is very important to keep in mind. Terrorists have no broadcast agency. They are online, of course. They do have their own online presence. But the actual violence is propaganda by the deed. It is useful. And then a concept of globalized vengeance. In other words, the enemy is hit no matter where they are. Modern day terrorists will actually declare entire populations to be their enemies. See, they'll hit this enemy wherever they are in the world. So vengeance does occur from the Western point of view. We retaliate. We do engage in certain airstrikes or whatever as retaliation. But remember that in other parts of the world, historical vengeance is expected. This idea of avenging one's repression. Another concept to keep in mind is this idea of globalized solidarity, this idea of international terrorism conspiracy theory, and whether there exists an international terrorist conspiracy. Remember the proxy wars. Proxy wars do suggest that a lot of the violence in the world is a result of the puppet masters of certain countries using various groups as their chess pieces. If you consider the world to be a chess match or a chess war, they use these groups as their chess pieces. And this is very common. The Russians do it. The Americans have done it. The Saudis do it. The Iranians, the Syrians. It goes on and on in the modern era. Because these nations do it now, this suggests that a terrorist networks may have certain central links, that these networks are being supported by someone. So in some respects, this is a course about conspiracy theories, because now we do enter into the realm about whether there is a hidden hand behind a terrorist attack. Which brings us to Cold War terrorist networking theory. There was a Western theory that Soviet proxies were the source of international terrorism. Well, there is some truth to that. This is uncomplicated and simplistic, but we are going to explore some political science theory now. So these are different terrorist environments, and we are going to take a look at them. So take out your theoretical thinking caps for a moment. And these are political science concepts that are very important. The idea of a monolithic terrorist conspiracy, and then multipolar terrorist conspiracies, and then the cell-based environment. So these are all different terrorist environments. Now, understand these, and just I'm summarizing these, but just understand them for right now. So these are the environments that we mentioned: monolithic, multipolar, and cell-based. The foremost participants in these environments, whether there is any state control, any group autonomy, and then how difficult is it for us to engage in counterterrorism against it? For monolithic theory, you know, if there's a single state sponsor, then it means that there is strong and direct state control, minimal group autonomy, and there are clear options. This is the easiest environment to counter simply because all one has to do is co-opt the state sponsor of terrorism. And what we see here is that there was a great deal of theory for a long time that the Soviet Union was behind all terrorism. Now, what is more accurate for the modern world is this concept of multipolar environments. In other words, there are several state sponsors where it is in strong multipolar. There are several state sponsors with strong and direct state control. This is important because what this means is that several countries engage in being the puppet masters behind terrorism. And there's minimal group autonomy, but there are still clear options. One just has to engage with the state sponsor of terrorism. And then the weak multipolar environment, which is when dissident groups basically help each other. There are several state sponsors, but state control is weak and insecure. Group autonomy is strong, and this is problematic because it is unpredictable. This is not an environment that one wants to be ascendant. And then, cell-based. It's when the foremost participants are simply dissident groups. The state control is very weak. Group autonomy is very strong, and this is the most difficult environment to counter. In other words, in the cell-based environment, what we see is that these are independent cells, that there are basically a great deal of difficulty for it fighting against it. Now, having said all this, let us evaluate these environments in the modern context. In the modern era, this concept of a monolithic environment is no longer with us. One cannot argue that there is a single state sponsor of terrorism anymore. The multipolar environments, though, do exist in the modern era. We find that certain countries have sponsored certain groups that have engaged in what we would call terrorism. It's not uncommon to find links going back, for example, to Iran. One could argue that there are links going back to Saudi Arabia. The Saudis have been caught several times engaging in acts of terrorism, which they, of course, deny. But they did occur. Russians will deny that they engage in terrorism directly, but they do have their own proxies. And their proxies can be as far afield as Ukraine or in the Middle East in Syria, where there have been any number of Russian-supported groups and Russian mercenaries have been found in the Middle East. The weak multipolar, the so-called free-floating revolutions, we'll get to that in a moment. What we find are that there are certain movements, such as Islamic State and their clones, Al-Qaeda and Al-Qaeda's clones, who do engage in this weak multipolar kind of activity. So they might have some links to some countries, but they are largely autonomous movements. And then, of course, the cell-based environment, which we have seen being demonstrated repeatedly. The cell-based environment is one in which people will simply become radicalized on the internet or elsewhere. And when they do become radicalized, they engage in terrorist activity in another country without ever having contacted necessarily directly the extremist group that they are carrying out the violence on behalf of. So keep that in mind, that we are now in an environment which is arguably the most difficult to counter, an environment that is arguably the most dangerous among these environments that we are discussing. If you have any questions, please do feel free to phone in, or feel free to send us an email and we will get back to you. So Let us continue by looking at the cell-based environment and the weak multipolar environment. We are going to look at, very shortly, a video, but before we do that, before we get there, I want you to understand that there's this concept of the stateless revolution that is occurring among religious radicals at the moment. Now, we could see this being picked up by other movements, such as the white nationalist or civilizational kinds of extremists. But for right now, keep in mind that, firstly, Al-Qaeda is the model, the modern-day model for the stateless revolution. They promote, as we know, they promote international terrorism among its followers and others. And there are many clones, many franchises of Al-Qaeda. Remember the concept of the Afghan Arabs. The Afghan Arabs are a good case study of individuals who have been trained in one particular conflict, and then they go back home. They are an international fighting force that is consistent of the Holy Warriors, the Mujahideen, who came into Afghanistan and then went back home. That model has been repeated a number of times, and it was repeated in Iraq, in the war in Iraq, repeated in the wars in Syria, in which these foreign fighters go in and then they go back home. So the Afghan Arabs are arguably the first generation of several generations of these foreign fighters and others who come in and are trained and are become battle-hardened, and then they return to their home country. We saw this in Bosnia, where Mujahideen fought with the Bosnian Muslims against the ethnic cleansing policies of the Serbs and the Croatians. Those Mujahideen, those holy warriors, also returned home. And then the terrorist violence in Iraq and Syria is extraordinarily complex and extraordinarily violent. There are many different puppet masters, firstly. We see that there are proxies fighting on behalf of the Saudis, the Iranians, the Americans, the Russians, the Syrians, the Turks, and others. So you certainly have the proxies. But what you also see are the stateless revolutionaries who are there. We see them who are fighting for their own cause, fighting for their own goals, who are certainly in Iraq and Syria. And this particular environment is very dynamic. It is continually evolving because of the behaviors of the supporting countries who come and go and support different groups at different times, but also the behavior of these ideas, the actual idea of Al-Qaeda, the idea of Islamic State, are very strong in these two conflicts. There are many case studies of stateless revolution. In a moment, we're going to see a video that reports the attacks on the American embassies in Kenya and Tanzania. But firstly, remember the Madrid train bombings. In Madrid, what we saw was that during the American phase of the war in Iraq, or the American phase and its allies, the Americans had the largest number of soldiers. The United Kingdom had the second largest number, and Spain had the third largest number. Well, what happened was, in Madrid, at the Atocha train station, a series of bombs were detonated. And here you can see the extent of the destruction. This is at the Atocha station in central Madrid. And what happened was, a series of bombings occurred. There were cells that had been embedded in Spain, sleeper cells, and they engaged in this activity, and there was a high casualty rate. The conservative Spanish government collapsed. A socialist government was elected or was appointed in Spain, and they immediately withdrew their soldiers from the Iraq conflict, which means that this was a very successful series of bombings by stateless revolutionaries. So you see how effective this can be. Then there's the case study of Islamic State in Iraq and the Levant, also known as ISIS. Islamic State is very adept in the modern era of inspiring fellow believers in other countries in the West, in the United States, for example, or in Belgium, or in France, and elsewhere, inspiring them to engage in terrorist incidents. These particular incidents, it does not mean that Islamic State is directly in contact with these individuals, but these particular incidents have had high casualty rates, and these individuals who carried out these attacks were inspired largely online by Islamic State, or what they saw on the television about what Islamic State is all about. So this concept of stateless revolution filters down to the cellular level among lone wolf terrorists also. Now, there is an important case study that you should keep in mind about the Kenya and Tanzania embassy attacks. There is a concept known as tradecraft within intelligence communities and others. And the idea behind, the concept behind tradecraft is that some people are very good at what they do. And the preparation is very detailed, very involved, very intricate. What you will see for in these particular attacks is firstly how well planned and well designed these attacks were on American embassies in Kenya and Tanzania. Secondly, you'll see that this we'll discuss the actual tradecraft among the operatives, the terrorists who embedded themselves in Kenya and Tanzania. And we will see how the Americans actually were unprepared, completely unprepared for this particular attacks. And then arguably, this was the declaration of war by Al-Qaeda against the United States, and we still did not entirely read what was happening against us. We did not really realize that some group, some movement such as Al-Qaeda, had actually declared war against the United States or Western interests. So let us go to this video, and then we'll come back and we will conclude by discussing the lessons of these attacks on American interests in East Africa. So we'll go to the video now.
1998, a truck loaded with explosives pulled up outside the US Embassy in the heart of Nairobi, driven by a suicide bomber. Now on BBC World News, Peter Taylor investigates the way these bombs ushered in a new chapter of the Age of Terror. Disturbing images from the outset in the last in the series.
Friday, August the 7th, 1998. Two men in a delivery truck set off from a suburb of the Kenyan capital, Nairobi. In the back, 1,600 pounds of explosives. Forty-five minutes later, the truck pulls up at the rear entrance of the United States Embassy. Symbol of American power in Africa is no more. Over 200 people were killed, thousands more injured. 3 years before 9/11, this was Osama bin Laden's first major strike in his jihad, his holy war against America.
It was a whack upside the head, a message that we chose not to listen to because we were tone deaf to terrorism at the time.
The attack took America by surprise, yet bin Laden had warned the world.
He said, "I'm going to take an incremental jump in violence every time we attack you until we get your attention."
This is going to continue. He was very clear about this. We're not just bombing you today. That this is never going to end.
This is a story of unheeded warnings, missed opportunities, the slaughter of innocents. Osama bin Laden's war on the West is the latest bloody chapter in the Age of Terror. May 1998, 10 weeks before the attack on the American embassy. American journalist John Miller was heading for a dangerous rendezvous on the Pakistan-Afghan border. His assignment was an interview with Osama bin Laden, who just issued a fatwa, a holy edict, declaring war on America and its allies. Miller's mission was shrouded in secrecy. To ensure maximum security, he'd agreed to put himself in Al-Qaeda's hands.
They had purchased plane tickets in advance for cash. They had flown us from place to place, but we never knew where we were going till we literally were getting off the plane there. And we crossed the border in the darkness, and when we got to the other side, there was the truck waiting for us, and we got on and we were off again.
Eventually, Miller and his team reached an Al-Qaeda camp buried deep in the mountains.
Bin Laden arrives in a cavalcade, a motorcade of three SUVs. He gets out surrounded by bodyguards. When he gets out, everybody points their guns in the air, and they have tracer rounds, so you can see them being fired through the night, and they launch fireworks and rockets and gunfire. And bin Laden is moving in this kind of caterpillar of arms and legs and bodyguards from the cars towards this little hut where we're going to do the interview.
Bin Laden had demanded a list of Miller's questions in advance. Just before filming, his number two, Ayman Zawahiri, approached Miller.
He said, "I have very good news for you. Mr. bin Laden has agreed to answer each one of your questions." And I said, "Excellent." He said, "There is one thing." I said, "What's that?" He said, "We will not be able to translate his answers to you." And I was very disappointed. I said, "Well, that's going to make it very difficult. How am I going to ask the follow-up questions?" He said, "This will not be a problem. There will be no follow-up questions."
Standing by.
Standing by.
Anytime.
Mr. bin Laden, you've issued a fatwa calling on Muslims to kill Americans where they can, when they can. Is that directed at all Americans?
فنحن نعتقد أن أكبر لصوص العالم اليوم هم أمريكا وأكبر إرهاب اليوم في الأرض هم أمريكا فلا تمييز بيننا بين الرجل لابس عسكري أو مدني بل هم جميعا نعتبرهم أهداف.
The interview over. Miller turned to Zawahiri and asked him when America might expect bin Laden's war to begin.
And he said, "Oh, you will see the results of this fatwa in the next several weeks." I remember walking away from that saying, "That's a little unusual. Usually they make a threat from a terrorist group. They don't put a time limit on it. They don't foreshadow that much. And here they're trying to tell us something's about to happen."
Nairobi, Kenya. Population 2 million. Targeted by bin Laden as the stage on which to launch his war on America. The US embassy was located in the city center at a busy junction. Lee Reed was a senior security officer at the embassy where he'd been posted with his wife. 8 months before the bombing, he sent his bosses a formal report warning that the embassy was at risk.
We had conducted a security survey in January and February of 1998, where we had examined the inside and the outside of the embassy and studied it, and realized that the embassy was very vulnerable to truck and car bomb attack. In fact, I took a photograph of the exact location the bomb eventually went off at, and placed it in a report.
You put this in a report?
Yes, and sent it off to Washington.
Around the same time, a man walked in off the street to warn the embassy about a bomb plot.
The walk-in advised us that we were under threat of a truck bomb.
A truck bomb?
A truck bomb. Mm-hmm. The information was taken, sent back to CIA, and I was told that the man was a fabricator, and therefore we did not need to take heed of what he had said.
In the months leading up to the bombing, Ambassador Prudence Bushnell repeatedly contacted Washington, warning of her growing concern about security. Eventually, she went to the very top, to Secretary of State Madeleine Albright.
I wrote to Secretary Albright after I had been told by people at mid-levels to knock it off, because I knew I was accountable for my community's security.
Well, that was the first part of a video which shows the attack on the American embassies in Tanzania and also in Kenya. Understand the lead up to that and what they were saying. More than 200 people were killed in that attack, and this was a declaration of war that was we ignored at the time. We were not aware that Osama bin Laden and Al-Qaeda were going to target us, and yet they did. Now, we're about to take a break in about in a moment, but before we do, I just want you to understand that they were attempting to get our attention. We did not pay attention to them beforehand, but this is how they decided to do it. And according to Osama bin Laden, all Americans are targets. All Americans are enemies, and that this war will never end. So, let us go to our break, and we'll come back.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
When I was here as a student was that I could do anything.
Sure, keep striving and keep reaching high, but at the same time, also lift up those around you.
I want to get up and work hard to change things for the future, to make things better. How do I make my passion come to life?
How can I share that experience?
How to shape and engage the community.
Get hands-on into making a difference.
My name is Makonnen.
My name is Johnny.
My name is Amarantha, and I'm a Toro.
Negativity. Instead, surround yourself with people who share the same goals as you. If you believe it, you can do it.
Watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hello, welcome back to Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. I'm Professor Gus Martin, and we're going to watch a bit more of the video that we had just seen, just to finish that up, and then we are going to see the remainder of the video. So what we're going to do is the purpose of the videos is to try and understand exactly how stateless revolution works, how well planned it can be at times, but especially this particular case study, because we are all familiar with what occurred on September 11th, 2001. And we assume that the current war on terrorism began on September 11th, 2001, but it did not. The first attacks against us by Al-Qaeda were in East Africa. So let us go now and finish this particular video, and then there will be another element to this, which you'll see in a moment. So let us go to the video now.
Not a reply.
No reply?
No. No.
The steady stream of warnings did register, but the response was not enough. Bin Laden had already identified the embassy's Achilles heel long ago. Back in 1994, he'd scrutinized photographs of the building and personally identified the optimum place to plant a bomb. When it comes to planning, Al-Qaeda is in a league of its own. Mombasa, on the east coast of Kenya, where radical Islam had taken root. An Al-Qaeda sleeper cell had been operating here undetected since 1994. Shortly after Bin Laden pinpointed the embassy, cell members moved in, set up a fishing business, married local women, and even started families. The cell would lie low for 4 years.
The cell operating in Mombasa had significant cover. There was a lot of support in the area for radical fundamentalists, and there were individuals involved in shipping and transporting weapons. In fact, we actually believe that some of the explosive material was brought into East Africa through a boat, and they were allowed to operate freely in the Mombasa area.
The CIA and FBI were aware of the growing threat from bin Laden and were monitoring his activities through a secret unit known as Alex Station.
So the key elements to take with you from this particular segment is, firstly, this idea of extraordinarily detailed planning. Osama bin Laden's skill, his genius, if you will, was organization and planning. So he was personally very good at what he did, as well as many of the people around him. You'll observe that there were sleepers that were positioned for 4 years in planning to carry out this particular attack. These sleepers were very good at what they did. They became married, they had children, they had families, but they were there strictly to be activated when ready. So let us see the second part, the remainder of this particular case study, because it is a very important one.
The CIA and FBI were aware of the growing threat from bin Laden and were monitoring his activities through a secret unit known as Alex Station. By this time, two Saudis had already been selected for the suicide mission in Nairobi. Jihad Muhammad Ali and Muhammad Alawali were now preparing themselves for martyrdom. 2 weeks before the attack on the embassy, an Al-Qaeda explosives expert arrived in Nairobi and began assembling a bomb powerful enough to reduce the building to rubble. Alawali and Jihad Ali were reunited in the bomb maker's rented house 4 days before the attack. Together, they went through the details of the plan. Meanwhile, the cell in Mombasa, which had smuggled in the explosives, was ordered to disperse. Leaving wives and children behind, they quietly slipped out of the country. On the morning of Friday, August the 7th, Alawali and Jihad Ali set off in a truck loaded with explosives. Alawali was carrying a gun and 4 grenades. Ellen Boomer had been working at the embassy for just 4 weeks.
I can remember it as clear as if it was yesterday sometimes. I had my cappuccino. I did that every morning.
I used to work as a driver at the agricultural office of the U.S. Embassy, and I was getting prepared for a trip.
Naomi Karonga worked for the Kenyan government in the 22-story building right next door to the embassy.
That morning of 7th August, Friday, I was in my office in a cooperative house, 10th floor.
I was in the building across from the small parking lot that was in the rear of our embassy. I was speaking with the Minister of Commerce.
That morning, I was at the back gate of the embassy, the place where vehicles load and offload parcels.
When the truck pulled up at the back of the embassy, Alawali jumped out and asked the security guard to open the gate. The guard was suspicious and played for time.
I said, yes, I'll open the gate. That's my job. But I haven't got the keys at the moment. You'll have to go to the reception.
Alawali reached for his grenades.
It was just me and the driver. And we were both standing there, and we heard this loud.
We went to the window to see what is going on.
Most people got up and went to the window.
I said, what was that? And he said, oh no, let me look.
Stuck outside the gate, Jihad Ali decided the moment had come. Through the embassy and the high-rise cooperative building opposite. The office block sandwiched between them collapsed like a pack of cards. Over 200 died. Thousands were injured.
If you're in a building bombing, what happens is that the blast of the bomb comes through the building like a tidal wave. It breaks glass and forms like sabers and so forth, goes through. And some of the glass is so fine that it'll go through your clothes and embed in your body, but your clothes won't be torn.
I lost my consciousness. I didn't think anything. I raised up. I started to run around to find a way out, to find what is wrong.
Was thrown across the room, knocked out just momentarily. Seconds later, one of my American colleagues came rushing in and saying, Ambassador, we have to get out of here. And we walked down 21 flights of stairs with hundreds and hundreds of silent, bleeding Kenyans who were utterly calm.
He was just trying to see how I can leave the building alive. And the one who really finished us most is the one who said, there is fire.
Somebody shouted, hurry up, there's fire. And again, the human mind is an amazing thing. I remember thinking, seeing the smoke and thinking, well, at least I'm not going to burn to death. I'll die of asphyxiation.
You know, there is fire. It's catching well. Am I in fire? Will I ever reach down? Am I dead? Am I dying?
It was not until I got out of that building that I saw what had happened to the embassy.
Inside the shattered embassy, covered in rubble, Ellen Boomer was regaining consciousness.
I was laying like this on my back, and I tried to get up, and I couldn't get up. And then I thought, it was a bomb. It was a bomb. And then I thought, do I hurt anywhere? Am I hurt? Is anything hurt? And I thought, no, I don't feel any pain anywhere. Nothing's hurt. And then my next thought was, well, I can't see. And I thought, well, that's just momentary. That's going to pass. And then I thought, oh, well, it might not pass. And then I thought, okay, God, you can have one eye. Don't take both of them. You can have one. Let me have one, and I'll let you have the other one.
400 miles away, a second truck bomb exploded at the U.S. Embassy in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. Twelve people died, nearly 100 wounded.
I was shocked. I mean, I was really astonished by the tradecraft, by the skill with which these attacks had been carried out. You only had to look at the first pictures to recognize that this was a different kind of terror, that this was terror that aimed at mass casualties in a way that most previous attacks had not.
News of the twin attacks soon reached the man who'd interviewed Osama bin Laden only 10 weeks before.
I was on a fishing boat 70 miles off the coast of Montauk Point in New York in the middle of the ocean, and my cell phone rang, and it was the news desk at ABC. They said, two U.S. embassies have just been blown to bits in East Africa, in Tanzania and in Kenya. What do you make of that? And they were trying to figure out, what are the issues involving terrorism in East Africa? What are the groups in East Africa? What are the issues with those countries? And I said, no, it's not about that. It's about us. This is Osama bin Laden. This war that he declared on America, it just started.
International terrorism has evolved to the point where the tradecraft can be as intricate as what you just saw, or it can be as low-tech as some of the vehicular attacks that have occurred in the West. Remember that with this particular scale of violence, we are seeing mass homicides that are intentionally being carried out. International terrorism that began with Black September was actually rather surgical. Remember that they took approximately 250 hostages, but allowed them to get off the planes before they detonated the planes. The modern morality of international terrorism is such that mass homicide is preferred. So the scale, the tradecraft, and actually the persistence of the modern new war on terrorism is different from the way it was in the past. The stateless revolutionaries are very active. They've been active at least since these attacks on the American embassies, and they continue. So keep that in mind as we go forward, because when you look at individuals such as Osama bin Laden, they had a very different vision, very different approach to what an enemy is, what legitimate targets are, and then the scale of violence that is used. So let us finish by looking at some examples of the stateless revolution. We can see that there are examples of secular, sectarian, and ethno-nationalist stateless revolutions. Secular is the old Japanese Red Army. They were a nihilistic organization that was very active during the 1980s. Then sectarian, we mentioned Al-Qaeda. We can also put Islamic State in this particular category. The point being, though, that the sectarian groups are now ascendant. They have the predominant profile for this idea of stateless revolution and international terrorism. And then lastly, there are ethno-nationalists. We do not see this being occurring as often as we once did on the global stage anyway, but there have been examples. For example, the PFLP and other groups were very active. So, keeping all of this in mind as we go forward, we need to remember that terrorism in the on the international stage is easier to mobilize, it is easier to do, easier to carry out than it has been in previous years, previous decades, and it shows no signs of being reduced at the moment. The cycle is still ascendant in terms of international violence. So, if you have any questions, please do feel free to look at the study site for the textbook. And if you have any questions, please come back to me. My name is Professor Gus Martin. This is Criminal Justice Administration 446, Terrorism and Extremism. During our next meeting, our next discussion, We are going to look at two cutting-edge typologies of terrorism. One is gender-selective terrorism, and then the other is criminal dissident terrorism. These are cutting-edge in the sense that many people debate whether they even exist. My argument is that yes, certainly, of course they do, but feel free to challenge that as we go forward. Feel free to question that and debate it, but this is what we're going to look at simply because there are people who are motivated by gender selection and by criminal dissident violence. So this is Professor Gus Martin, and we'll see you next time.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
You know, I feel like before I was just by myself. I'm not gonna get distracted by anything or anybody. I'm just here on a mission, that's what I thought. But I started to realize that I don't wanna be just a student, I wanna be like a motivation to somebody.
I love my job. I wanted to be able to have a place, like a laboratory on campus, that people could actually get hands-on into making a difference. The CSUDH Urban Farm is one part of the operation that we're building here. We have energy systems, we have food systems, we have transportation systems, and we're trying to make them more sustainable.
I started to volunteer a lot to just let myself get exposed to different things that I wasn't used to get out of that comfort zone.
One of the reasons I teach here is because my own artwork has a really strong tie to the LA community. There's some really amazing artists who live and work in South Los Angeles. They want to work with our students. And when they actually meet these artists, it's like very transformative. They start